Good morning, everyone. Welcome to all of you and those of you who are joining us online. And we're just going to start with a song right now as you come in and prepare our hearts to worship the Lord together through song, through meditation, and in Jesus' name, too.
Amen.
Amen. This is my good friend from Ottawa. His name is Jono. All right, we're gonna get started. Let's all stand together. Do it again, John, I'm sorry.
To you.
Good morning. You may have a seat. And welcome once again to our Sunday service, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers who are here today and watching us online. So as we enter this time of worship, let us hear our call to worship coming from Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all peoples. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. For the Lord, the Most High, is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. He subdued peoples under us and nations under our feet. He chose our heritage for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loves. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the peoples gather as the peoples of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. Now let us join together in our opening prayer. Lord, you alone are worthy of our praise and worship. Thank you for being our Heavenly Father, adopting us as your children, and willingly sending your own Son to this world to pay the penalty for our sins. We fall short of your glory each day and confess our sins to you now. Let us continue. We pray that you will create in us clean hearts and renew in us the joy of your salvation. Thank you that we have assurance of our pardon through Christ Jesus, our great high priest and our King. In his name we pray. Amen. And our assurance of pardon is from John 6, chapter 6, verses 37 through 40. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. And let us continue to worship our Lord and Savior.
Well, it brings me great joy to have my two children with us this morning on Father's Day. Yeah. Amen. And our good friend from Ottawa, he leads worship in Ottawa. Yeah, we haven't seen him in a while, but the last time he played with us was about 11 years ago, right here in that corner. Do you remember that, John? Do you remember that?
I remember being here. I don't remember the corner bit.
Yeah. So we've known John for a long time. He's a good friend of ours, and he's staying with us for the week. So be sure to say hello to him at the end of the service. And of course, Daniel, I mean, he's been with this church now for, what, 30 years?
Forever!
Yeah, so it's good to have him here with us too. Let's celebrate together. Let's seek the Lord. There's always more of the Lord. And so let's just come before him and say, and humbly and just say, Lord, I need to hear from you today. Amen? Amen. Let's all stand together if we can. If not, that's okay.
Thank you. They are many, his mercy is more.
Let's sing that chorus one more time.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
To our time for our tithes and offerings, let us remember, the Bible encourages us to give with an attitude of generosity, not reluctantly or under compulsion, but cheerfully according to our means, and prioritizing one's church when giving. With this in mind, we encourage all to continue to do so, knowing that this is for the support of the ministry of our church, the relief of the poor, and the advancement of the gospel works. And I would invite the ushers to come forward and to take up the offering at this time. And at this time, we're going to join together in prayer. So I will lead with a prayer, and then we'll join together as a congregation to say the Lord's Prayer together. So let us pray. Lord, you are our heavenly and perfect Father, and we thank you for that. And as remember today is Father's Day, Lord, we pray for the fathers in our midst, Lord, that we may raise our children in your ways, Lord, and that you will give us the strength and wisdom to do so. We pray for those also who have lost their fathers or who are unable to do so. Lord, just thank you. May they find their comfort in you as Father, Lord, that you never leave us, nor do you ever abandon us, and you are always there. And we just pray also just for the world, for peace at this time, Lord. There's so much going on with the war, with cost of living and everything, Lord, just that we may be, you may care for each one of us, Lord, and that we put our hope and trust in you as well. And we just pray the words that you taught us together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All right, at this time, I would invite Pastor Marvin to come forward for a dedication.
Good morning, church. Today is a special day, and I want to invite Dave and Laura and baby Joshua to come here. And they want to open with some words in this time of dedication.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. I beg permission to say something to you all. Mostly to say thank you. Thank you for all of the great things that you guys have passed on to us. You know, he spent the whole winter wearing Asher's coat. He's sleeping in Otelia's crib right now, and I think he has all of Oscar's pants. So many others as well. This was given to us by Joshua and Pooja. And so all of the blessings that you gave to us. I think a lot of you know that this was a long time coming for us. I think that's obvious, at least when you look at me, anyway. And it was something we'd hoped for a long time, to the point where it was a disappointment, a grief that we had, and something that we had to let go of for a while. But you guys didn't. You were very faithful in praying, especially Anne, very enthusiastic about the idea of us being parents and keeping that alive, I guess. And it's something about community that, you know, we talk about sharing each other's griefs, but we also store up each other's hopes that we as a community are able to hope for, pray for, keep alive the things that people need and want, even when they themselves are not able to hope for it themselves. Mm-hmm. So it's a great relief, frankly, to be here finally, and to be standing in front of you all doing this. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Well, Joshua, your name means God or Jehovah saves. Joshua took over after Moses' death and leads the Israelites into the promised land. Joshua is considered one of the Bible's greatest military leaders for leading the 7-year conquest of the promised land, and often is held as a model for leadership and a source of practical application on how to be an effective leader. What a beautiful name, eh? But this leadership, Joshua's leadership, didn't come from him. We read in Joshua chapter 1 in verses 3 to 8 that God was encouraging him. God was his salvation. God was his strength. And we see in verses 3 that says, I will give you every place where you set your foot as I promised to Moses. And then no one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. And verse 7, look at the ways God encouraged Joshua and the ways God will encourage baby Joshua. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Notice that doesn't say in your hands. On your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Isn't that our prayer for Joshua today? May God be your salvation always, Joshua. And may the Lord give you the blessings he gave to his servant Joshua. Be strong and be courageous. Keep his word in your heart as a treasure, so then you can offer God's salvation to many people. Amen. And today, the purpose of this moment is to help you as parents fully embraced. Now I'm talking to you too. To fully embrace the sacred call to raise up your child in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And so, in keeping that purpose, will you respond by making these promises before God? Do you recognize and solemnly declare your dependence on Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit for wisdom, help, and blessing you will need to guide and nurture your child?
We do.
Oh, we do too.
Do you commit yourself for creating a Christian home where you will bring up your child in the knowledge and love of God, read the Word of God regularly, and pray both with and for him?
We do.
Yeah.
Do you intend to raise your child in the church family, relying on the body of Christ to help you and him to grow in Christian faith?
We do.
Will you encourage your child to receive Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior through confirmation when he will publicly profess his faith in Jesus and confirm for himself the vows that you have taken today?
We will.
We will, with
God's help.
Amen. So now I want to invite all of you to stand up, because there are some questions that I want to address to all of you. I was talking first to Joshua, then I was talking to Dave and Laura, and now I'm talking to all of you. This family is relying upon us as God's people to support and help them to raise up this child in the Christian faith. This means, listen carefully, volunteering, teaching, mentoring, leading by example, and discipling him individually and through our various children ministries. Welcoming and treating young people as valued members of our church family. Listen carefully. being patient with him as he grows and learns, and above all, praying for him. Are you willing to accept this great responsibility? Please, if you are, repeat after me. We do God helping us. Can you say it one more time? Amen. You may be seated. So, Joshua Nicholas, oh, look, this way, so then you are not going to be seeing me. Joshua Nicholas Thompson, today I dedicate you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. So now, let us pray together for Joshua. Heavenly Father, we pray that you will take Joshua Nicholas Thompson into your loving care. Abundantly enrich him with your grace. Bring him safely through the perils of childhood. Deliver him from the temptations of youth. Lead him to a personal knowledge of Christ as Savior. Help him to grow in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and people, and to persevere in his faith. Uphold the parents with loving care, that with wise counsel and holy example, they may be faithful to fulfill their responsibilities, both to Joshua and to you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, and his people says, amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you.
Amen. All right. Yeah, I'll quickly run through announcements and then you're up again.
Okay, perfect.
For announcements, Vacation Bible School is happening in just a few weeks now as we approach the end of the school year. So July 11th through 15th, 9 a.m. to 11:45 a.m. for ages 3 through 10. If you haven't registered your child, you still can. Info is available for that on our church website. We are still looking for some volunteers as well, so please let Mary Jean or Andrea know if you're able to do that. If you email, it's info@firstcong.ca. And that's all for announcements, so I'm going to invite Pastor Marvin up again, and this time Miriam as well.
This past week, we were celebrating Miriam's graduation. So this morning, as a church, we want to pray for her. We want to present her and congratulate her for this accomplishment. Miriam in the Bible was a wonderful woman, was a sister that took care of his brother Moses. You remember? He was this woman that was singing and dancing when God delivers the people of Israel from slavery.
And play the tambourine.
So our prayer, Miriam, for you these days, as you begin this new journey in your life, as you finish one step in your life, and you begin a new one, that you will continue looking at him,
to celebrate his faithfulness, his goodness, and his love and care for you. And as a church, we want to say that we love you. We recognize as a valued member of this church, and we will pray that the Lord will bless your future. Amen. So please point your hands to Midian, and we're going to be praying together. Amen. Lord Jesus, High Priest, the one who rescued us, the one who saved us, the one who presented his blood before God the Father and for Midian, we come before you, giving you thanks for your salvation, your purpose and plan for Midian. We ask you that you will continue growing in her your spirit, so then she will be a light and salt in the world, and she will be a blessing in all that she will do from now on. Please give her wisdom. Please give her a dependent spirit upon you for everything. And above all, Lord, I pray that you will keep always a song and praises on her mouth to celebrate always your goodness and faithfulness for her. In Jesus' name, we pray, amen. You're welcome. Thank you, Miriam. And now, I want to invite Song Lee to come here. This is her last Sunday being here among us, and next week she is going back to Korea. But I know that all of you know her. I know all of you will remember the way that she was serving the Lord among ourselves. I know that you will always remember how she was always displaying this attitude of love and service for Jesus. And I know that you will always remember that she came here without knowing about Jesus. And now she is going back to Korea being a child, a daughter of the living God. That is the most amazing miracle that we can witness. There is nothing great that we can see that someone being in the darkness and now staying in the light and walking as son and daughter of God. And we are seeing this in the life of Song Lee. I am thinking, this is crazy, but I have been telling her, she is our first missionary in Korea. But today, I want us together to pray for her, to bless her, and to ask God that she will keep her, that she will guard her, that she will provide a place where she will continue growing in her faith, going back home. Amen. So again, your hands. Let's pray for Song Lee. Lord, how beautiful it is to see the miracle of salvation and to see that Song Lee has been walking in your light, has been walking in faith, knowing that you made her a daughter of the most living Father. We pray for her. that wherever she goes, she will be blessed by you. She will be guided by you, and that she will take this message of salvation wherever she goes and be a blessing, as you promised that you were going to bless all the nations of the world through faith in Jesus. Thank you for this precious gift that you gave us for these past two years. And thank you, Lord, for the ways that you blessed us as well, every Sunday, being here and serving all of us in this church. We pray for her. We bless her. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 At the entrance, there are some cards for Song Lee, some empty cards that you can write something for Song Lee so she can take those things, those cards, and read them while she goes back home. She will remember us then. And another prayer. I want to invite Aziv. This morning again is her last Sunday being with us. And as well, you know her. You know how she has been coming faithfully and being part of this church. And now that she is moving to another province, we want to tell you that you are a gift for us here at First Congregational, and that we will keep you, amen. And we will keep you in our prayers. And we want to pray as well this morning that wherever you go, wherever God is moving you, you will continue being a blessing for others. Amen. Let's pray for Aziv. Lord, I want to give you thanks for this precious gift that you gave us. Thank you for this beautiful smile that we found every Sunday here at the church. This beautiful spirit of service. Even though, Lord, we sometimes were not able to communicate with her, we knew that she felt that she was part of this family. And we know that she was part of our family too. So we pray for blessings. We pray for guidance. We pray that the Holy Spirit will open doors, will open a way wherever she goes. And that she will keep walking in the light of your face all the days of her life, and that she will remember always that she has a family here in Halifax. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Aziv. And the last one, this past week was Carr and Kathy anniversary. How many years? 32. 32. So congratulations, Carr and Kathy. We love you, and we are grateful for what the Lord is doing among us through you and your love and service as well here at First Con. Amen. And that's all for today, I think. Don't go, because the worship service will continue. But it's beautiful to see this family and what God is doing among us. Amen.
All right. Now I would like to invite Anne Amanda up for the children's prayer, and then Miriam is going to come up and read the scriptures for today.
morning, everybody. Good morning, kids. Can I see a wave from the kids? Oh, I'm so glad you guys are all out on this beautiful, sunshiny Sunday morning, and you guys have a great lesson in plan. Anna Patricia is going to be teaching you guys about Jacob wrestling with God. Yeah, so it's going to be exciting. I'm going to pray, and then you guys can go downstairs. Father in heaven, thank you for bringing us here together. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity to learn about you, for these young minds and young hearts to be open to your word. I pray that you would stir their spirits to know you and to hear what you are teaching them through Anna Patricia today, Lord. I pray you'd give Anna Patricia the words to teach, and the kids would have open, attentive, and patient ears to listen. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, go downstairs, kids.
Good morning, church. Thank you for all the congratulations and prayers. It's nice. This morning we're reading from Hebrews chapter 9, verse 1 to 10. Now, even the first covenant had regulations for worship and an earthly place of holiness. For a tent was prepared, the first section, in which were the lampstand and the table and the bread of the presence. It is called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was a second section called the most holy place, having the golden altar of incense and the ark of the covenant covered on all sides with gold, in which was a golden urn holding the manna and Aaron's staff that budded and the tablets of the covenant. Above it were the cherubim of gold overshadowing the mercy seat. Of these things we cannot now speak in detail. These preparations having thus been made, the priests go regularly into the first section, performing their ritual duties, but into the second only the high priest goes, and he but once a year, and not without taking blood, which he offers for himself and for the unintentional sins of the people. By this, the Holy Spirit indicates that the way into the holy places is not yet opened as long as the first section is still standing, which is symbolic for the present age. According to this arrangement, gifts and sacrifices are offered that cannot perfect the conscience of the worshiper, but deal only with food and drink and various washings, regulations for the body imposed until the time of the Reformation. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's open with a word of prayer. Lord, we come before you knowing that this is your word. You gave it for our training, for our edification, and to understand the way of salvation, which is through faith in Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, make your word do all things for us by faith in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Last Sunday we were talking about a better high priest for all of us. And this morning we are going to see in chapter 9 that not just we have a better high priest, but we have a better place for worship, a better tabernacle. The Old Testament tabernacle contained items that symbolized great redemptive truth, great salvific truth, showing what sinners must do to approach a holy, 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 three times holy God. Although beautiful and impressive, the tabernacle still did not give the sinner real access to God. Even though God ordained the old covenant worship system, it had all kinds of limitations because it was just a model. It was just a picture of the one to come. I have been following with attention the construction of the new building around the corner here at Quimple Road. 2 years ago, there was nothing there. They just put a giant sign with a picture of the model of the building for about 3 months, but that was not the building. Later, they started to lay down the foundation of the building, and soon, it seems to me that they will finish the construction. What do you think they will do with the sign they have there now? It's going to disappear, of course. There will be no need anymore for the image because we will see, as we are starting to see, the real building. Let's say I buy a condo there. And when I receive the keys, I said to them, "Oh, no. Thank you very much for the keys, but I just want the picture." Yeah. You will think that I am losing it, right? And this is what the Holy Spirit tells us through the book of Hebrews. Through the Old Testament, God always sought to have a relationship with his people. But for this to happen, there are instructions to follow because God, again, I need to repeat this, God is holy, 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 three times holy. So, for this to happen, in order that God have a relationship with his people, there are instructions to follow. We cannot come before God as we want, in the ways that we want, on our own ideas, because God is holy. Habakkuk 1:13 says, "The eyes of the Lord are too pure to look on evil." You cannot, says God, cannot tolerate wrongdoing. God cannot tolerate sin. So how did God solve this problem in the Old Covenant? Well, first, in verses 1 to 5 in the scripture that we just read, remind us that God established an earthly place of worship. It was called the tabernacle. The tabernacle was a large tent where God's people worshiped him. So if you go with me and let's read these verses again very quickly, verses 1 to 5, and says, "Now even the first covenant had regulations for worship in an earthly place of holiness. For a tent was prepared, the first section in which were the lampstand and the table and the bread of the presence. It is called the holy place. And behind the second curtain was a second section called the most holy place, having the golden altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant covered on all sides with gold, in which was a golden urn holding the manna and Aaron's staff that budded, and the tablets of the covenant above it were the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat. Of these things, we cannot now speak in detail, which we are really grateful this morning. So, I have an image there to show you the tabernacle. So, as I am going through this tabernacle, you will be able to see on the screens there the tabernacle. So they came into the tabernacle through the only door in the tabernacle. There was only one door. And they offered the blood of animals when they sinned. But that was as far as the people could go. In the tabernacle, there was a small tent, the tent of meeting, and is the red part that is there in this, almost in the center, one side of the tabernacle. This tent of meeting had two rooms, and only the priests were allowed to enter there. Only the priests were allowed to go and serve in the holy place, which the Bible tells us is the first section, and you will see it there before the curtain. In the middle of the tent of meeting, there is the first section. But again, remember what chapter 9 of Hebrews is telling us here. This was just the picture, the sign, the model of the real building. And by the time the Holy Spirit inspired this letter to the Hebrews, the real and eternal place of worship had been established by Jesus Christ. So now let's go back to the tent. The tent was divided in two sections. The first section is called the Holy Place. In this first section were the lampstand that you can see there. It's very small, but the lampstand is the far corner in your screen. There you have the lampstand. Then you have the table with the bread of the presence and the altar of incense. The second section was named the most holy place or holy of holies. God's people held this room as the most holy place on earth because it was there where God, in a sense, dwelled on earth. Now, the whole tabernacle was holy, but there was a progression to enter to the presence of God. First, you see the courtyard. Then you can see the holy of holy, the holy place, I'm sorry. And then the last part is the holy of holies. So let us talk about a bit about the most holy place. Our passage tells us that there was in that place the Ark of the Covenant. This Ark of the Covenant was a box covered in pure gold that contained the two tablets of the Ten Commandments given to Moses on Mount Sinai. It also included a jar of manna from their time in the desert, and also the staff of Aaron that budded when the sons of Korah rebelled against God in the desert. But at the top of the Ark of Covenant was the mercy seat, a fancy name for the lid on top of the Ark of Covenant. The mercy seat was covered in gold, and on top were two cherubims overshadowing the Ark of Covenant. Now, at the end of verse 5, it says, of these things we cannot now speak in detail, because the purpose in mind of the writer of Hebrews is to tell us that the tabernacle was just a picture, was just a sign representing the real place of worship. This tabernacle was never designed to be eternal. It was intended to be limited and incomplete. It was imperfect in what it could do for the people in the relationship with God. As beautiful as it was just a sign. Now, let's go and read verses 6 and 7. If you go with me to Hebrews chapter 9, verse 6 and 7 says, "These preparations having thus been made, the priests go regularly into the first section, performing the ritual duties. But into the second section, only the high priest goes, and he but once a year, and not without taking blood, which he offers for himself and for the unintentional sins of the people." Here we see how the priests minister or serve inside the tabernacle. So we hear about the furnitures first and the location of the furnitures, but in verse 1, but now we are moving to what happened actually inside in the tent of meeting that you have there. First, we learn the job of the priest when they enter the holy place. That is the first section. Some of the responsibilities included keeping the oil on the lampstand, burning incense at the altar of incense, and bringing bread to the table. But even though priests were closer to God when they were in the holy place, only the high priest was allowed to enter the Holy of Holies once a year, on the Day of Atonement. The high priest, dressed in special garments, sacrificed a bull, and then came into the most holy place, presenting the bull's blood and sprinkling the blood with his fingers on top of the mercy seat. But that was an offering for his own sins and for the sins of his family. Then after the payment for his sins and the sins of his family, he had to go back. He had to go out to the courtyard to get a goat, sacrifice it, and bring the goat's blood into the Holy of Holies to pay for the sins of Israel. This second time, the high priest represented the people before God. And if you are like me, that gets a little uncomfortable hearing about blood, please forgive me. You can ask my wife what happens to me when I see blood, and she will give you a graphic explanation. I faint, I see nothing, and I need to be in a chair or in a bed. It's horrible to talk about these things, right? But when someone offered the blood of an animal, that animal took this person's place. You will find many times in the Old Testament this saying, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. This means that when they offered the blood of an animal, they were offering the animal's life instead of theirs. And the point is this. Sin is so serious before God. No matter if it is one sin of 10,000 or 10,000 sins, one sin in a person's whole life is an insult against a holy, holy, holy God. Ezekiel 18:20 says, the soul who sins shall die. Death is the only payment for the debt of our sin. In the old sacrificial system, this is what you would do to be reminded of repeatedly. You would be reminded daily about the seriousness of sin and how costly, again, how costly sin is against God. Ah, but don't dismay. Here comes the beauty of the message of the gospel revealed here in chapter 9. If you read with me verses 9 to 10, it says, Hebrews verses 9 to 10 says, which all this is symbolic for the present age. It was just a sign, a model, a picture. According to this arrangement, gifts and sacrifices are offered that cannot perfect the conscience of the worshiper, but deal only with food and drink and various washings, regulations for the body imposed until the time of reformation. This was just only to help you with the external things. But look what is, notice at the end of verse 9 what it says. The time of reformation. For you and me, the time of this reformation is now, and the time of this reformation is here. This sacrificial system sounds horrible to us, but the good news is this is how it was. This was the picture of the building, but we don't need the picture of the building anymore because we have the real one. We will never have access to God's presence in the old covenant, not in a million years. Think about it. First, you needed to be from the lineage of Abraham. You needed to be part of the people of Israel. Then you needed to be from the tribe of Levi. And then if you wanted to go to the very presence of God, you had to be from the lineage of Aaron. And then to be chosen to enter the Holy of Holies. Not a chance in a million. You cannot get access to the presence of God. Hebrews is telling us here that this is how it was then. But this is how it is now. Because of Jesus, the time of reformation is fulfilled. And the time where you can access God is here. Verse 9 says that the old covenant sacrifices could not clean your conscience from a sense of sin and guilt. Do you know why? Because they were offered year after year, over and over. Repetition was a reminder that there was no final forgiveness for the sinner by the blood of animals. Yes, it was a beautiful system that pointed to a better system for the forgiveness of sin and for a clear conscience. But now, the new covenant is here. That is the beauty of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ once for all for the sins of His people. And it needs no repetition. Jesus Christ is the intermediary. Jesus is the sacrificial lamb that loved you so much that He put Himself on the altar for you. Jesus is the bread of life represented by the bread of the presence to satisfy your every need. Jesus is the lampstand, the light of the world who shines into the darkness. He is the altar of incense that intercedes for us day and night before God the Father. In Jesus, now you have everything what you need to come close to God. The heart of the glorious gospel is at the cross, where Jesus sacrificed His life for you and for me. And at the cross, Jesus accomplished several things. At the cross, God's holiness was vindicated. Sin is erased, and sinners are forgiven. God's justice is not anymore at risk. Was on Jesus. The wrath of God was on Him. Not over you anymore. This is how it is now. Because of Jesus, our conscience have been purified through the blood of Christ. So we have no reason to hide from Him anymore. This is how it is now. Because of Jesus, we don't need to hide our sins or try to hide from God as if we ever could. This is how it is now. Because of Jesus, we don't need to be concerned about coming to our Heavenly Father. Hebrews 4 tells us, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace. This is how it is now. Because of Jesus, Though we often do and should grieve our sins, when we sin, we need not to be haunted by our past sins. My dear friends, just that is a good news, at least for me. All my sins, all my past, all the things that I am ashamed of, have been forgiven and forgotten forever. This is how it is now, because of Christ. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful illustration that we learned today from the scriptures. I pray that someone today is dealing with guilt, shame, they will come to you and take you of his or her sacrifice and presented that before God the Father to gain full access with confidence to the presence of God. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together and let's pray this beautiful hymn that says, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty." Early in the morning, our song shall rise to you. Why? Because of Jesus. Amen. Let's sing together with a loud voice this last hymn. Amen. Our song shall rise to thee. Amen. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.
Who says what, though?